Hello and welcome to Tesca Technologies Private Limited. In this video, we are going to understand about Tesca's analog lab trainer kit. The order code for this trainer kit is 33502. So this trainer kit basically gives the experience about different analog circuits and circuitries using these different function generators, breadboard circuits, and user can get very hands-on practical experience of analog circuits through using an experiment on this kit. So now I will explain you the different parts of this kit, different blocks which we have derived and designed to perform different experiments, and the rest of accessories will also be discussed. So now I will explain you the different parts. So this is first block, which is the DC power supply block. So this contains fixed and variable supply both. So fixed supplies will be 12 volt supply, and variable will be 0 to 20 volts supply DC at 0.5 ampere. So this is the toggle switch to select the fixed or variable supply. Similarly, this is the second block. The second block also consists fixed and variable supply, but in this is the negative 12 volts and 0 to 20 volt supply at 0.5 ampere. Moving on, this is the third block. The third block consists DC power supply plus minus 5 volt at 1 ampere. So this is the ground terminal, this is the plus 5 volt terminal, and this is the minus 5 volt terminal. Now for moving on, we will move to fourth block. The fourth block consists AC power supply at 0.1 ampere. So this is the 0 volt terminal, 5 volt terminal, 10 volt terminal. Similarly, 5 volt and 10 volt terminal of AC power source. At 5 block, this is the power on off switch to on and off this kit. Now moving to 6th block, the 6th block consists of function generator. This is the inbuilt function generator in this kit to perform the different analog experiments in which we require different frequencies selector through this. This consists 1 Hz to 110 Hz frequency, and this is the frequency 0 to 11 multiplier, and this is the amplitude to give the high and low amplitude to the frequency. These are also function which gives the square wave, triangular wave, and square and sine wave at different locations through this potentiometric switch. Similarly, there is also a function modulation generator, modulation circuit. So this gives different frequency ranges through 1 Hz to 10 kHz, and these are the different frequency of modulations and different type of function waves which are including sine wave, triangular wave, and square wave. So moving on to the 8th block, this is the breadboard circuit. In this breadboard we will insert the solderless components, and we will design the experiment to be performed on the analog circuits. Now we will move on to the 9th block. The 9th block consists a digital multimeter or a digital current meter which gives 20 volt voltage supply and 200 milliampere ampere supply, which will be reads the different current and voltages. Now moving on to the 10th block, this gives a LED bulb indicator to test the continuity of any wire and any other apparatus resistance like this, and this is the buzzer which gives the buzzer indication when we test the continuity, and also LED light to give the blink testing. So now moving on to 11, this is the potentiometer of 1K, similarly at 100K, and similarly again 100K. So these are 200K potentiometers, and this is the 1K potentiometer which will be required to give the different resistance and voltage ranges to vary the voltages through this potentiometers. Now these are the two toggle switches on and off. As requirement, we will use these toggle switches in the experiments. So now we will also explain the accessories. So these are different types of patch cords and hookup wires as well, which are provided with this kit, and the user manual which consists of many of experiments to do and practice the analog circuits. Apart from all this, we are also providing a list of a number of components to perform different circuits and exercises. The components will be provided with this kit in the accessory section. Now I will show you the different values and different resistance and voltages on this analog circuit lab. For this we will first power on this kit like this, and now we will check the different blocks of this kit. For this we will use this DMM and set this DMM at DC voltage range of 20 volt. First we will first test the first block, which is our DC power supply block. So this is at the variable, the toggle switch at the variable supply. So now as I increase the voltage range, this will give the voltage value of 0 to 20 volt DC. So this is the 18 and 19.99 around value, which is the approximately 20 volt. Similarly, we will move this toggle switch to fixed supply, and this will show the 12.22 volt, which is the fixed DC supply, which will required in different sections. So the variable supply does not affecting this. Similarly, this is the block 2, which gives negative power supply. I have wrongly connected this. So this is the ground and this is the positive of this supply. You can see in fixed terminal, a fixed toggle switch at fixed selection, this will giving minus 12 volts, and at variable selection it will give 0 to 20 volt in negative. So these are the negative supply of 20 volts. Now we move on to the DC power supply of 5 volts. So from this meter we will check this supply. So this is the 5 volt plus and this is the 5 volt minus, which is showing at this. Now we turn this knob to the AC voltage range and we will measure the AC voltages, which are fixed voltage around 4.5, and these are 9.5. 10 volts around, and this is the 5 volt AC and 10 volt AC. So these are the different voltages. Now we will set this DMM to 2000 ohm resistance range, and we will measure the resistance of this potentiometers. You can see here. So this is the 1K resistance potentiometer. As I increase the value gone around 1000 ohm, which is the 1K ohm. Now similarly, I will increase this resistance value to 20K and 200K. So we will measure the 100K potentiometer. So as I increase the value, you will see the value from 0 to 100K around, which is the 97K. Similarly, at this point the value goes 0 to 100K. So these values will be required in the practical experiments. Now we will test the continuity of this toggle switches. So at this terminal, this is the toggle switch which is not showing continuity right now. As I on the switch, you can hear the beep sound of this multimeter, which gives the continuity. So this is the normally connected terminal when we on the switch, and this will be the normally open connector when we off the switch. So similarly, at this point you can hear the beep sound of the DMM. Now we will test the continuity of this continuity tester. So I will take this patch code and we will put this patch code in. You can see the buzzer is buzzing and LED is blinking when we test the continuity of this probe. So this is the continuity tester to test the continuities of the any other equipments. Now I will test this digital multimeter from this power supply. So this is the fixed power supply. So I will connect ground to the negative of this DMM and we will set this DMM to the 20 volt voltage range as we are measuring the voltage here. So, and the positive of this value at positive. So this is the fixed 12 volt value which we have measured at the multimeter also, and as I turn this to this variable, so this will be the 19 volt. As our meter is able to measure the value till 19.99, so this is the 19.88 around value, and as I decrease this value you can see the meter shows the zero value or the zero voltage value. Now we will move on to the function generators. For this we will require DSO, so I will install the DSO here. As you can see, we have installed the DSO here. Now we will connect this test probe to X channel and now we will see the output waveforms from this function generator block. For this we will connect the ground terminal here and output terminal here, and we will press the auto, or you can see the waveform of 1 hertz because the selector switch is at 1 hertz, and the frequency we will as down this frequency. So you can see the frequency is around 1 hertz at this time, which is measured by the DSO. So this will be going to 1 hertz to 10 hertz, which is the multiplier of the frequency as I increase this. So frequency is right now 9.95 hertz, which is showing in the sine wave. And as I increase this potentiometer of frequency range to 10 hertz, so you can see the frequency is increased. Then I decrease this frequency by this frequency range multiplier, so the frequency is decreasing in the sine waveform. So this is the 10 hertz, and as I increase this to this move to 10 hertz to 100 hertz, so this is the 100 hertz frequency. And on higher, this is the 1 kilohertz frequency. So as we decrease the volts per division, we will see the 1 kilohertz frequency, and on higher this is the 10 kilohertz frequency. The frequency can be now moved more than 10 kilohertz to 110 kilohertz. So this is the 110 kilohertz frequency from this function generator. So frequency is around 110 kilohertz, and these are the different types of waveform selectors. So right now this is the sine wave, you can see here, and now as I change this, so this is the triangle wave and this is the square wave. So these are the different functions of function generator which we have derived here. Now we will see the modulation function generator. So these are the modulated 10 kilohertz frequency here, and these at the 1 kilohertz, 100 kilohertz, 10 hertz and 1 hertz. So I will select the 100 kilohertz, and as we increase the frequency range, the modulation range also increases, and the amplitude of this frequency and the modulation will be lower and higher through this amplitude selector. And we can also select the different type of modulations frequency type. So this is the sine wave right now, and this is the triangular wave, and this is the square wave modulations. So I will decrease the amplitude to proper. Output. So this is the square wave output here, modulated output, and by increasing the frequency you can see the frequency of this modulated output is also increasing. As I change this to triangle, you can see the modulated output of triangular wave, and frequency can be vary from this frequency selector or frequency multiplier, and the amplitude can be higher and lower. Similarly for sine wave, this is the modulated output of different frequency ranges. So these are the different functions which I have defined now from this kit. Now we will move on to the different experiment with different components. So some of experiment I will show you and perform at this kit. So now we will do our first experiment on this kit. For this, the first experiment is to study the diode in DC circuit. So this is the circuit diagram which is given in the user manual. So we will first do the forward connection. From this we will use a diode in the forward connections. For this we will use connect 20 volt power supply to the diode and also measure the voltage and current graph, and we will plot the characteristics of this diode in the forward bias. So for this we required diodes IN4007 which are provided with this kit in the component accessories. Now we will place this diode on the breadboard circuit at any of the point properly. This is the unique solderless design, so the any of the terminal or the components can easily be placed at any point while working. So this is the diode which we have placed here. Now we will give 20 volt DC supply to this diode. For this we will connect positive to the upper terminal strip of this breadboard circuit. So this is the positive end, and we will give the negative, and we will connect this negative to any point for right now. Now we will connect the this 1K resistance in front of diode. So the resistance will be connected here. Remember, before doing the electrical circuit connections, the kit should be in off position. If you are doing the circuits while the kit is on, you can damage any of the parts or you can give shocks to yourself also. So for safety purpose, always switch off the kit while making the connections. So now we will connect a digital multimeter to measure the voltage of diode. For this we will connect this positive to the positive terminal of this diode, and negative will be with the negative of this power supply. So these are the negative terminals connected. Now we will also connect this ampere meter to measure the ampere range. For this we will connect positive of this ampere meter to the positive or the other end of this resistance like this properly, and the negative of this ampere meter will be common with all the negatives which we have used in this circuit. So this is our circuit for forward bias has been done. Now we will power on the circuit. Before this, once you should always verify the connections, so the damage of components and the other kit damages will be prohibited. Now we will power on the circuit, and as I increase the voltage, current also increases. So this is the, we will note down the readings from 0.1 on the 0.01 interval. So this is 0.01, 2, 3, and as the voltage reaches around 0.06, higher than 0.06, you will see the immediate and exponential increase in diode current. So this is the forward characteristics of the diode till the voltage breakdown current voltage reaches. The current of the diodes increases exponentially. So this is the forward biasing mode of the diode. So these are the voltage and current characteristics. After note downing the all the readings, you can easily plot the graph, and you will see the graph will be same as given in the manual. So this is our first experiment of this analog lab. So now we will move on to the next experiment, which is one of the experiments of this manual, which is to study the half wave rectifier. For this, we will require on the component, on the kit, we will use 0 to 10 volt AC supply, which is at the block 4, and we require diode IN4007 and one resistance of 1k half watts and the electrolytic capacitor of 47 microfarad at 25 volts. So these are the all apparatus which are required and also provided in this kit. So now we will place this diode as per the circuit diagram which is given in the manual. So we have placed this diode at the breadboard circuit like this, and in this diode's parallel we will add the 1k resistance. So this is the 1 kilo ohm resistance. The resistance will be connected in the parallel of this diode. So other end will be connected at this point, any of the blank terminal strip like this. And now we will use the electrolytic capacitor. So this is the electrolytic capacitor, which is the polar capacitor. In this, the white strip denotes the negative and other end will denotes the positive. So positive and negative are also given in the circuit diagram. So we will connect the positive end of this electrolytic capacitor to this diode, and negative end will be connected to the blank terminal strip. So the negative will be our output. Now we will extend this electrolytic capacitor's negative, the hookup wire, at any blank strip. From here we will see the output. Now we will give the 10 volt AC supply. So from the AC power supply at block 4, we will connect the ground terminal to the 1k ohm resistance here. So the ground terminal is connected to the 1k ohm resistance, and also this capacitor needs to be connected the ground. So the ground terminal of this capacitor, which is extended here by this hookup wire, will also be connected to the ground. So these are the negative terminals of both the capacitor and resistance are now ground. We will give positive supply of 10 volts to the diode. So this is the circuit which we have completed now, and we will observe the waveforms at the CRO. For this we will connect this CRO at different terminals as described in the manual. So we will observe the different waveforms. For this we will power on the circuit. So now we will power on the circuit. The circuit is now power on. Now we will use this CRO to observe the waveform at the input. So we will connect this CRO at point 1 and 2, which is the input terminals. So the second number point is the common of the CRO, and this is the positive terminal. So here we can see the almost AC sine wave which are given in the manual also. These are the output sine waves. Now we will, so these are the input sine wave which is given to the diode circuit. Now we will see the half wave rectification from this circuit. So we will connect this positive lead to the electrolytic capacitors, and so these are the half wave rectification output with the 3 and 4 terminal short, which is at this circuit. You can see in the manual this is the last one output. As I remove the short points of 3 and 4 terminal from the circuit, which is this wire, you can see the proper half wave rectification of this AC sine wave at the CRO. So this is the half wave rectifier which we have made from this circuit and this analog lab. Now we move on to our next experiment, which is to study the common emitter configuration of NPN transistor. So this is the NPN transistor circuit which is given in the manual. We required a transistor BC107 which is provided in the component kit, and a resistance of 5k1 at 1/4 watt and a resistance of 100 ohm of 1/2 watt. So these are the different combinations and different components we are required. We also required other apparatus, DC ammeters to read the 0 to 200 volt milliampere microampere, and a DC voltmeter to measure the 0 to 20 volt voltage range, and different patch codes, stackable patch codes of 4mm to 1mm and different sizes. Now we will prepare the circuit. For this we will first install this BC107 transistor. So this is the emitter terminal of this transistor, and this is the base, and this is the collector terminal. So now we will install this transistor in this breadboard circuit like this. So our transistor has been installed. Now we will use the 5 volt DC supply for this circuit. So we will connect 4mm patch code positive to the 1k potentiometers positive, and negative or ground of this 5 volt supply to the ground. Now we will connect output of this 1k potentiometer to any blank terminal strip here like this, and this will be connected with a 5k1 resistance. So this is the 5k1 quarter watt resistance which will be connected with this potentiometer's output, and the other end will be connected to any blank terminal like this, and the front end of this resistance will be going to a milliampere meter. For this we will connect this DMM positive to this resistance terminal. Like this, and negative of this terminal will be connected to the base of this BC107 transistor. So this is the connections. Now moving forward, we will connect the collector, or sorry, the emitter of this BC107 transistors to the ground. So the ground of 5 volt is here. We have connected this the emitter at the ground. Now we will give the 20 volt supply, variable 20 volt supply. The negative of this supply will also be connected to the ground terminal or the common emitter configuration. So this will represent the common emitter configuration of variable 20 volt supply. Now the positive of this 20 volt supply will be connected at any free blank strip or a vertical strip of this breadboard. Now we will use the 100 ohm resistance of 0.5 watt and connect this 100 ohm resistance with the 20 volt power supply like this. Moving forward, we will use the 200 milliampere power supply negative connected with this resistance. And which connected with this digital ampere meter and positive. In front will be connected to any blank strip. From here we will take a voltmeter . This will be connected to the collector of this transistor, and we will take the supply from this collector also, and the negative of this voltmeter will also connected to the 20 volt power supply's negative, which is the common VC. Here we can measure the VCE at this meter. Now we will add a meter, a digital multimeter, to measure the base emitter voltage, and we will connect this at the base terminal positive like this, and this negative will also be connected to the common terminal of this collector. So we have installed 3 meters here. For this one measure VBE, base emitter voltage, and this one measure VCE, which is the collector emitter voltage, and this one will give the base current. So we will set this to the current milliampere range, 0 to 20 milliamps range, and this will be set up to the 0 to 20 volt DC range, and also with this meter will be set up to the 0 to 20 volt range. So that's how our circuit has been done. Now we will verify this circuit. Always verify the circuit you have made while working with the components, so the component damages will be prevented. So after verifying the connections, we will follow the procedure, which is saying that we will power on this circuit and see the different readings at the all multimeters. Now we will set the base current to the zero by wearing the 1K potentiometer. So this is the base current which are showing at this meter. So as I increase the voltage from this potentiometer, the current goes down. So we will make this current to zero. You can see the current reaches to zero value. So this is the zero value IB currents. Now at this point the transistor has in conducting mode. So now we will increase the DC variable power supply of 0 to 20 volt, and this will increase the value of VCE, the collector meter voltage. By varying this value, we will also note down the base current. The collector current from this collector ampere meter which we have connected. So we vary the value from 0 to 5 volts. We do not give this value to more than 5 volts. So this is the 5 volts supply which we have given to this VCE terminal, and at this time note down the current of IC in the circuit and plot the graph between VCE and IC. This will give the output characteristics of this transistor. So this is the output characteristics you will find from this the VCE versus IC current. Now after setting down the VCE current to 6 volts, now we will increase this to 6 volts. So this is around 6 volt. Now we will increase the potentiometer and note down the VBE corresponding to IB. So this is the VBE voltage, and we will increase or decrease the voltage of this and note down the value for different ranges of current. And now we will plot the graph between VBE and IB. So these are the input characteristics of this transistor which we have noted down here. After noting down the all readings, you can measure and plot the graph between VBE and IB. This will give the input characteristics of this transistor. So that's how we made the circuit to derive the different characteristics in the common emitter configuration of the transistor. So now we move on to our last experiment for today, which is to make a differential amplifier. So we are using some of these components, which is IC741, resistance 100 ohm 1/4 watts, resistance 10k of 4 watts 1/4 watts, and polyester film capacitor of 0.1 microfarad. So these the components we are required. We use the function generator which is available on the kit, and also we are using CRO which we require to see the output of this differential amplifiers. So we will make this circuit which is given in the manual through the components. So we will move on to the circuit diagram. So this is our IC741. So this is the IC741. So these are the 8 terminals of this IC, and this is the cut which shows the start and stop of this IC pin terminals. Here you can see properly. So this is the number 1 pin of this IC, and then number 2, 3, 4, so on moving, 5, 6, 7, 8. So all the pins are described in the manual, that and which pin which component will be connected. So this is the IC. We will connect this IC to this breadboard circuit on this 5 straight horizontal vertical terminal strips. So all the four blocks of this breadboard are defining or connected with the first number pin of this IC. Similarly, these are all for the second number pin, and then all are for 3 number and 4 number, and so on from 1 to 8 terminals. Now we will add this 100 ohm resistance from any blank vertical strip of this breadboard, and we will also connect this to any vertical strip. Now moving further, we will connect the 1 microfarad, 0.1 microfarad capacitor, and this capacitor second end will be connected to the second number terminal of this IC. So we will use a hookup wire for connecting this. So the hookup wire will be connected here, and this will be connected to second number pin of this IC. So this is our connections. Now moving further, we will connect the 10k resistance in the circuit. So the 10k resistance will be connected with both the points of capacitor and terminal number 2, and this will be connected at any blank. The output, so the second end of this resistance will be connected at 6 number terminal of this IC. So this is the 6 number terminal. All the terminals are connected, all the points are connected with this 6th number terminal of this IC. So we will connect this resistance at 6 number terminal, or the 6 number pin of this IC. Now we will connect 10k resistance again to the third number point or third number pin of this IC like this, and we will leave blank this resistance other end. We will connect the ground terminal here. Before this, we will give the positive supply of 12 volts which we require to power on the IC. So we have select the fixed value which is giving 12 volt positive. So 12 volt positive will be connected to 7th terminal of this IC. So this is the 7th number pin of the IC. Properly connect the wires or the patch cords. Now we will connect negative 12 volt supply to the pin number 4th of this IC. So this is the negative 12 volt supply. This will be connected to pin number 4 like this. And now we will connect the ground. So we can see the ground is common of this 12 volt supply of positive and negative. So we will take only one ground, one of them, and this will be provided to the 100k resistance which is here. And now we will give input from this function generator here. So this is the output of the function generator, and this will be given as an input to this differential amplifier. So this input will be given to this 10k resistance one end, and ground will be connected with the ground terminal of 12 volt supply. And now we will, for checking the output, we will use this CRO's probe. So the positive probe will be connected at terminal number 6, at which the resistance has been connected. So this is the positive, and the negative will be common with all the ground terminals. So these are our connections that has been done. The circuit diagram has been completed. Now before power on the circuit, we will verify. So we will verify our diagram. After this, we will on the circuit. So in the function generator, we will select the frequency around 100 Hz. So this will be the 100 Hz, and the function generator will be given 1 kHz as we fully turn this potentiometer to anticlockwise. So it will give around 11 or 1 kHz, 1.1 kHz. And this will be given a triangular waveform. We will require triangular waveform to give this function generator from this. So our input will be a triangular waveform of around 1.1 kHz frequency, and the output should be the square waveform after we on the circuit. So we will check our output after power on the circuit. So as I power on, you can see at the CRO the frequency is about 1.1 kHz. You can see here, and this is the output of square waveform from the this differential amplifier. So as I vary the amplitude from the function generator here, you can see the output also vary with this. You see the output of the waveform at the CRO is varying as I decreasing the amplitude of frequency. Also, if I decrease the frequency level from this frequency range selector, you can see the output waveform also varies with the frequency. So if you want to see the input waveform, you can remove this CRO probe from the output terminal and connect this CRO probe to the input terminal. You can see the input waveform, which is a triangular waveform of around 1.1 kHz frequency, and the amplitude can be adjusted and changes by this port. So this is how we made the differential amplifier and take the output as a square waveform, which whose input is given as a triangular waveform. So that's how we done the circuits. So here you can see, as I explained some of the experiment which are given in this user manual with this kit, so you can do and verify and complete the circuit diagrams making with these components which are all provided with this kit, and get a very hands-on experience and practical experience on analog circuits through this kit. So find when you're doing the experiments, if you find any difficulty, you can contact to Tesca Technologies Private Limited for all the support. Thank you.